Good morning. All right. Sorry we're running a little late. And I left my readers this morning, so I found some in the lost and found. So if anybody recognizes your glasses, just let me know. I'll give them back to you after the thing here. So, you know, certainly praise God this week for the rain that we've had. Ooh, I cannot see you when I put those on. So certainly praise God for the rain we've had. I think we're all appreciative of that. I wish we could have held off on the 45 degrees a little bit, but, you know, it is what it is. We'll take it. So got our prayer request list here. Sorry, I'm settling in a little bit. You know, continue to pray for those on here. Reese Lester. I see my mother-in-law's laughing at me, so I don't know if I'm making. I'll settle in. Appreciate all the hard work that goes into, you know, last week we had a pretty good business meeting, lots of things discussed, so we got those kind of pushed through, and we certainly appreciate those that were able to stick around for that. What do we have coming up? We have a chili cook-off. I'll go to John on that. We are, as mentioned, we're talking about looking for a custodian. I think we've got a candidate we're looking to talk to as the personnel committee, so more to come on that. We are looking to get a youth and music minister role out there. Youth minister, but we've talked about music minister as well. Rick does a great job. That's certainly nothing. I said something about that last week. My wife, or a couple weeks ago, my wife said, "You have talked to Rick, right?" And Rick is aware, but I think we're just looking to see filling the youth minister role that we've had open for quite a long time. John has certainly been, he and Tiffany have stepped in and helped cover that for 2 years now. It's been great, but we're, you know, it's time for us to get them some help and get them some relief. So, John, if you'd like to talk for a second, I think you were talking about the chili cook-off.
Just the same as like last year, we're trying to get it revived and going again. So last year, Wade and Kayla, they had their chili one last year. So this year, looking for a new chili king. So it's going to be on the 12th after service. So if you're interested in doing a pot of chili, it's all used to help raise funds to go towards our youth group. So you'll be able to vote on your chili and whatnot, whichever one you like the most. So the one that raises the most money is the one that ends up winning. So we look forward to doing that. We're going to try to make it an annual thing every year. So this will be, since we started back up, our second one. So.
Second delayed annual. That's certainly now we have cold weather for that, so that's great. One thing we did do last week at the business meeting I wanted to kind of draw attention to is Ken and Beth. They're here today. I won't draw attention, make them come up here or anything, but they've asked to join the church. We voted on that, and so we certainly welcome them and thank them. Yeah.
Good morning. It's good to see y'all this morning. How about this weather? This is great. Vaughn was out there with no shirt on this morning. He loves the cold, don't you? So tonight, I know it's a little rainy, wet, but we're going to have an archaeological presentation I'm going to give tonight at 6. And this is about identity markers of the early church, early Christianity. And identity markers are kind of like iconography. We don't see the cross till it comes years later. But what presence was left behind from this early church in those first through third centuries? And so we're going to look at that from an archaeological, historical aspect. So hope y'all can come. There's no Ranger game today. And the Cowboys play here right after lunch, so that's no excuse there. All right. Let me go to today's scripture. It's from Psalm 33. Psalm 33, verse 8. He says, "Let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the inhabitants of the world stand in awe of him." Stand in awe of him. One day when we go home to see Jesus face to face, what are we going to do? You're going to drop to your knees in awe of him, of the splendor and the glory. And we're going to sing here at hymn 547, "I stand amazed in the presence." And that's where we're going to. So if you'll stand with me, we'll begin worship.
Thank you.
song, hymn 2, Holy, Holy, Holy. Ask God's blessing on the offering.
Father, I just pray for each and every opportunity that we have to come to be in your presence, to sing your praise, to glorify you. Lord, there is no greater purpose than glorifying the God that created us. Father, forgive us where we failed for this day, for the offering that is given. Lord, may we be ever faithful to you and all things. Lord, we pray for the peace of Jerusalem. Yes. Lord, at these troubled times, troubled people, evil within this land, in the land of Israel, all over this world, Lord, we know that even your angels fight for us. We just pray for that. Lord, do with heaven as you open your word. Cleanse our hearts.
Thank you. Okay, I think we're ready. Are you disappointed? Are you desperate for help? You know what it's like to be tired and only a shell of yourself. Well, you start to believe you don't have what it takes, 'cause it's all you can do just to move, much less finish the race. But don't forget what lies ahead. Almost home, brother, it won't be long. Soon all your burdens will be gone. With all your strength, sister, run wild, run free. Hold up your head, keep praying. This road will be hard, but we win in the end, simply because of Jesus and us. It's not if, but when. So take joy in the journey, even when it feels long. Oh, find strength in each step, knowing heaven is cheering you on. Cross has brought heaven to us, but make no mistake, there's still more to come. When our flesh and our bone are no longer between where we are right now and where we're meant to be, when all that's been lost is made whole again, these tears and this pain no longer exist. No more walking, we're running as fast as we can. Consider this our second wind. Almost home, brother, it won't be long. Soon all your burdens will be gone. With all your strength, sister, run wild, run free. Hold up your head, keep pressing on. We are almost home.
We'll dismiss Children's Church at this time. Follow Miss Valerie here. One of the most important things that we do as Christians, as the church, is prayer. How many of you believe that prayer is effective? It's one of the most important things that we can do, and it's highly stressed. And we're going to look at what James has to say about prayer today. Have you ever prayed for something and you keep praying and then you just kind of give up praying because it's not answered? You don't feel like God's listening. Or what kind of season you're in. Maybe you're at a time when you're starting to lose a little bit of faith and doubt starts to set in when you pray. And the prayers feel kind of half-hearted. Anyone been there before? I think the Christian walk is with ups and downs with our faith, and doubts come. I think that's natural. But one of the most important things that's missing from the church today in a post-Christian America is prayer. D.A. Carson said this. He said, "What is both surprising and depressing is the sheer prayerlessness that characterizes so much of the Western church. It is surprising because it is out of step with the Bible that portrays what Christian living should be. It is depressing because it frequently coexists with abounding Christian activity that somehow seems hollow, frivolous, and superficial." And one more, John Calvin said, "To know God as the master and bestower of all good things, who invites us to request them of Him and still not go to Him and ask of Him, this would be of as little profit as for a man to neglect a treasure buried and hidden in the earth after it had been pointed out to him." We have a powerful God, and through His Son, Jesus Christ, who says, "Come to me, ask," and yet many of us do not ask. But the prayers we do send up, how are they sent? In what state is our heart and our minds when we come to Him with these requests? To pray with selfish intent means to pray with the right motive. First, we have to align our hearts with God. And if we tune in with Him, we will want things of heavenly nature, not of things of the world. 1 Kings 3:9, Solomon asked God for an understanding mind to govern his people. And James talked about some that ask wrongly with the wrong motive. So look with me at James chapter 4, starting verse 1. James chapter 4, starting with verse 1. He said, "What causes quarrels and what causes fights among you? Is it not this, that your passions are at war within you? You desire and you do not have, so you murder. You covet and cannot obtain, so you fight and quarrel. You do not have because you do not ask. You ask and do not receive because you ask wrongly to spend it on your passions." You ask wrongly to spend it on your passions. There was a mega church prosperity type preacher who once told the congregation, "If you just ask God for that red Corvette, you'll get it." Solomon, he could have asked for anything. To be rich, to be the greatest, most powerful ruler, for unlimited room service, name it, right? But unlike this prosperity preacher, he didn't ask for those kind of things. He didn't ask for the newest tricked out chariot. He asked God for wisdom to govern his people. Give him the ability to govern the people. His heart was aligned with God's. And although he acquired all these riches, that came later. His heart was aligned with God's, and God blessed him because of that. After our hearts are aligned with God, it means our trust is in him, right? We trust in him to be in control, to lead us, to direct our path. And when our trust is in God, we will pray for his will to be done. Christ's model prayer in Matthew 6 says that Christ is teaching his disciples for God's will to be done before any other petitions, any other requests. He said, before you come to me with your requests, ask his will to be done. Praying for his will to be done on earth as it is in heaven. In heaven, everything, everyone is perfect, right? Everyone is doing exactly what God had planned, had intended. They are living for him, doing his will. But here on earth, because of a sinful nature and the ability to choose to do God's will, we don't always do his will, do we? Not everyone. Because this is a fallen world where Satan has power. Satan tempts us. He distracts us, gets us off our course. We must always be on guard to fend off those temptations and distractions from Satan and pray for God's will to be done. We also need to pray with confidence in our Creator. Confidence. Ephesians 3:12 tells us, in Christ Jesus our Lord, whom we have boldness and access with confidence through our faith in him. And then in James 1:5, James chapter 1, verse 5, he says, if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask God, who gives generously to all without reproach, and it will be given him. But let him ask in faith with no doubting, for the one who doubts is like a wave of the sea that is driven and tossed by the wind. For that person must not suppose that he will receive anything from the Lord. He is a double-minded man, unstable in all his ways. James is calling us to prayer without doubting. And if we have doubt, it's like a wasted prayer. He's saying it's just praying in the wind. We pray without ceasing. We also pray without ceasing. In James 5, turn to chapter 5, verse 13. Chapter 5, verse 13. It says, is anyone among you suffering? Let him pray. Is anyone cheerful? Let him sing praise. Is anyone among you sick? Let him call for elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith will save the one who is sick, and the Lord will raise him up. And if he has committed sins, he will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for the one another that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person has great power as it is working. In verse 14, the elders of the church were praying over them. You know, here on Wednesdays, we meet and pray for the church, for the community, and we'd love for y'all to come join us. This is very important for the church to do. At my previous church, we met once a week. A group of men would meet on a Thursday morning, have coffee, and pray for the church. And we've got to have that within the church. Verse 16 says, prayer of a righteous person has great power as it is working. And here it says, in a righteous person. But in chapter 1, verse 5, it says, without reproach. So one of the questions a pastor asked me a few years ago, he just asked the whole congregation, do you consider yourself righteous? And many people not have an understanding of that, you know, they didn't raise their hand, you know, I don't want to seem self-righteous, is what they were thinking. but righteous. Everyone that is saved and believing and not practicing sin, you are righteous, right? Are you a righteous person? It doesn't say that God grants the request of those that practice sin, because everyone sins. But practicing sin is what separates the righteous from the reproach, as it says in chapter 1, 5. Then verse 16, he says, as prayer is working. As it is working. You know, I haven't always had the full confidence without doubt in my own life, my own walk with the Lord. As we said, they go up and down. Let me tell you about a time when my a prayer was answered. This was back in 2015, I recall. And I was commuting back and forth to the seminary in Fort Worth. And I get about halfway there. I think I'm around Saginaw area, somewhere in there. And Valerie calls me, and she said, "Hey," she texts me. She said, "Meridian's not breathing." So she rushed Meridian to the urgent care real quick. She was gasping for air. And so, you know, I'm in traffic. I pull over. First thing I do, I pull over, and I just pray. I found a Walmart parking lot. I had full faith in my God that He was going to heal her. Not heal her, but make her have breath again. I had no doubt whatsoever. The God of the universe, who is the creator of all things, can do this. And there's many times we come to God not with that full faith. We have a little bit of doubt in there. I don't know if God can do this, you know. But I had so much faith at that time. I was already thanking God for giving her breath. Thank you, Lord, for already giving her breath. I know you have answered my prayer. About a minute later, Valerie texted me and said she's breathing. That's the God we serve, folks. Amen. I know many of you probably have examples of that same thing has happened numerous times. Those are the kind of testimonies that people want to hear that increases their faith, encourages them in their prayer and their walk with the Lord. So how big do you think God is? Or how big are you letting God be? In your mind, is He sovereign? Is He able to do exceedingly great things far above anything we can imagine? Did He not make the heavens and the earth? Did He not part the sea? Did He not send His Son, Jesus Christ, and raise on the third day? Yes, He did. God is capable of anything that your faith allows. God is capable of anything that your faith allows. Now, we could go and look at this a little deeper about how, you know, in the early church, there were signs and wonders and speaking in tongues. And there's many that dismiss that today. However, I am not so bold to say that God can't work that way today. God is capable of doing anything He wants. I haven't actually seen this happen. Some of you may, I don't know. There's some that believe that the speaking in tongues and things ceased at that early church. Like I said, I haven't seen it, but I'm not too quick to say that God can't do that. He can do anything. Also, we have to pray fervently without ceasing and keep on praying. Look with me at James 5, continue reading in verse 17. Elijah was a man with a nature like ours, and he prayed fervently that it might not rain. And for 3 years and 6 months, 3 years and 6 months he prayed. It did not rain on the earth. He didn't give up. Verse 18, then he prayed again. I love that. Then he prayed one more time. And heaven gave rain, and the earth bore its fruit. The early church father, Hegesippus, from 2nd century, recorded that James was allowed to enter the temple precincts, where he used to pray for so long that his knees were like that of a camel. Are we praying once and then give up? Elijah here prayed for 3 years. Then he prayed one more time. Wow. Pray without ceasing. Maybe that first year just wasn't the season. It's all in God's timing, right? We trust in Him. He knows what's the best plan for us. His plan is best. Just keep on praying. In closing, I'm going to ask a few questions to think about as you go home for this week. Is my heart aligned with God? Am I asking for His will to be done? Or do I have selfish intents, wrong motives? Am I praying without doubt or with faith in the omnipotent God? Am I praying fervently without ceasing? Let's go, Lord, in prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, maker of all things, we thank you, Father, for your love, for your grace, a grace far beyond what we deserve. Father, forgive us where we have failed you, Lord. Forgive us when we have little faith, when we are in doubt. Father, I pray that you would increase our faith. Help us to see you for who you are, the great God, the one and only. If there's anyone here, Father, this morning that needs to get right with you, I pray that they would right now. That they would recommit their lives with you. We pray this in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. All right. What song we have here? Heart of Worship. Will you stand with me?
When the music fades, all is stripped away, and I simply come.
I'd like to invite you during this time, if you have something you confess, Lord, just come down here to the altar. Bring it before Him.
Something that's of worth that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus.
song. It's all about him. I'd like to ask, Wayne, would you mind closing prayer, please? Thank you, sir.
Father, we love you. We thank you for this day, Lord. We thank you for this opportunity that we've had to gather together and worship you. I thank you for this church family, Lord, and what they mean to me. I just pray you bless each life, each person, and their family. I just pray, God, you'd help us to have that faith we need to walk daily with you and pray without ceasing, Father. We thank you for the words you've given us today. We thank you for our pastor. Pray, Lord, that you bless him and his family, Valerie, and all the kids. We just ask, Father, you go with us now this week. Help us to walk truly to you, Father, and keep our eyes on you, because it's all about you, Jesus. We pray all this in his name. The Lord's people said,
Amen. Amen. Amen.